Recent news out of the U.S. that the Federal Reserve has raised that benchmark rate 25 basis points. But the language out of the central bank suggests that ongoing rate increases will be appropriate. Very different language from the Bank of Canada, who have suggested a conditional pause.
Not very surprising. The Fed is still very hawkish in the language, and they have to remember, if you are the Fed and you start to be soft on inflation and you're saying everything is under control, guess what will happen to the bond market? Long-term interest rates will go down. They have to fight it, because on the one end, they are raising interest rates to slow down the economy. On the other end, if you sound too optimistic about inflation and everything is fine and you're ending raising interest rates, that will lower long-term interest rates and will sabotage what they're doing. So they have to keep this kind of language, although maybe they are not meaning it. I think that what they have in mind at this point is one more move that will take the upper limit to 5% and they call it a day. But they cannot say it, because the minute they say it, the bond market will react and will sabotage what they're doing. So they have to keep the market guessing. And that's, I think, what's happening now.
Let's talk about that path of policy going forward. How long will we be in this wait and see situation?
Yes, so our call is that the next move will be another 25 basis points. And then, as I said, they will call it a day, they will rest. The question is, okay, you are at 5% upper limit. What next? When are you starting to cut interest rates? Usually the gap between the last hike and the first cut is relatively short, a few months. This is not going to be the case this time around. I believe that the Fed will sit on its hand until early 2024. Why? Because they have to make sure that inflation is dead before they start cutting interest rates. You don't want to repeat the mistake of the 1980s, where you had a double dip recession. You want to wait until inflation is absolutely dead. And if it means keeping interest rates higher for longer, so be it. Now, the market, and that's crucial, the market is now expecting the Fed and the Bank of Canada to start cutting in the second half of the year. To the extent that the market will be disappointed by that, that means that the bond market, and even to an extent the stock market, are a bit too optimistic about the first cut and therefore might be mispriced. We expect some correction in the bond market over the next few months as the market starts realizing that the Fed is not going to cut in the second half of 2023.
Let's talk about some of the data that has come out over the past few months on both sides of the divide and what the numbers are telling you and how that might play into the path for both central banks.
Well, first of all, inflation is improving. That's really good news. No, most of the improvement is in the goods segment of the market, reflecting the fact that the supply chain is improving. If you do a month over month on an annual basis, we're talking about the core goods inflation, you know, outside then energy and food, is approaching zero. That's when it comes to goods. So it's all about services. And even there, you see some improvement. You see some slowing in the wage inflation in Canada and the US. So the inflation story is behaving. The move from 7% to 4% will be relatively quick. Maybe by April, maybe we will be there. The trick will be to move from basically 4% to 2%. And that's where the job market enters. And that's where we get numbers that are mixed. The vacancy rates in the US are still rising. So the market is tight, and therefore wages will not go down as quickly as the hope in the Fed and the Bank of Canada. And that's the trick. So all eyes are on the job market that is still relatively strong.
Let's talk about rate sensitive sectors such as housing. And tell us what's happening on both sides of the divide.
Yes. So first of all, let's talk about the U.S. And the number one force to deal with is rent. Rent, listen to this, that's amazing. Rent accounts for 40% of core inflation in the U.S., 40%, which means that if all other prices will be zero, given the fact that rent inflation is 8% in the U.S. now, it means that overall inflation, core inflation in the U.S. will still be 3.8%, even if all other prices are zero. Now, that's the bad news. The good news is that the flow, namely new contracts, new leases, are now rising at the inflation rate of close to zero. So the stock is 8%, the flow is zero. So we know that it's a question of time until the stock will start going down, because more and more of the flow will get into the stock, namely new leases will be more and more dominant. And that's important because that's, again, 40% of core inflation. So I'm optimistic about rent inflation in the US actually slowing down, helping the Fed in its fight against inflation. Now, Canada is different because we don't measure rent inflation this way. We don't measure housing inflation this way. Actually, one component is interest payments in our method. Interest payments are rising. So the Bank of Canada is raising interest rates to soften inflation. At the same time, interest payments that are part of CPI rising. That's why the Bank of Canada's life is a bit difficult to deal with. Having said that, clearly the housing market is slowing down, and it's slowing down relatively quickly. And that's a good thing, because we went through 46% increase in house prices during COVID. If you don't see an adjustment, that's a bubble. So this adjustment is very, very healthy. It will continue, I believe, over the next few months. However, from a fundamental perspective, in a year, 2 years from now, we still have this huge demand coming. And as I suggested, official numbers underestimate the number of newcomers into this country. I estimate in 2022, roughly 950,000 people enter this country, new immigrants, non-permanent residents, foreign students, and people from Ukraine. Close to 1 million people, and none of them carries their house on their back. So clearly, we need some solution to this. The supply is not there. We are not building enough. In fact, we are building less. And that's something that will visit us 2 or 3 years from now. When the demand is there, the supply will not be there. So short term, this market is correcting, but it's not a free fall. It's not a meltdown. It's reallocation of activity over time. 2 or 3 years from now, we will see the pressure building because the supply is not there. The inventories are not there.
Benjamin, we've seen strong job numbers on both sides of the divide as we head into that summer season and that summer, I guess, seasonal job market. What is the expectation there from the labor markets?
Yes, that's a good point. But we have to remember one thing. One of the reasons why companies are hiring a lot of people is because of the fact that their existing labor force, many of them are actually sick. We cannot ignore this reality. The number of hours lost to sickness has risen dramatically in 2022, more than we have seen in 2021 and 2020 during COVID. People are sick. In the US, you have 16 million people with long COVID, and we have a tough winter. We all know the story. So in order to replace those people that are sick, you have to hire at least on a temporary basis, and that's why we see this increase. What it means, come spring, this will disappear because the seasonal aspect of the flu, COVID, will be softer. And that's something that we have to take into account. So maybe the labor market is not as tight as perceived, given what we are seeing in the numbers. Nevertheless, wages are still rising, and the Bank of Canada and the Fed will keep interest rates high for longer to make sure that this housing market and this labor market starting to soften. And that's exactly what will happen over the next 6 months.